Welcome to IRA's online classes. Let me introduce myself. My name is Mithun. I've done my postgraduation in English Language and Literature from Kerala University. I've been in the field of teaching for competitive examinations for almost 10 years. And I've been with IRA's Institute for almost 5 years now. Now we'll go for some of the previous year questions that we came across in the examination. When you go for a grammar part of the examination, we're going to focus mainly on 8 topics. Like in the grammar part, like parts of speech, tenses, subject of agreement, modifiers, parallelism, punctuation marks, articles. So these are the topics that we need to focus mainly on when it comes to the grammar part of a test. I'll take you through some previous year questions. When you take a grammar question, the concepts of all the topics must be thought about. Only then we can find out the error. In the case of spotting the error, our task is to find out the part that contains the error. And in order to identify the error in a sentence, you need to have a good knowledge of all the concepts that come in all the topics. That means you need to examine every sentence starting from the beginning. Divide a sentence into different parts, apply the concepts of all the topics that appear in all the topics to find out the error in a sentence. When it comes to sentence improvement, our task is to find out the option that improves a statement. So see whether the given statement is grammatically correct or wrong. If it is grammatically correct, there is no improvement required. And if it is grammatically wrong, we need to go for an option that makes it grammatically correct, right? Now, when it comes to our examination, when you take any type of question in the verbal part, whether it's sentence improvement, spotting, there are parajumbles, reading comprehension, when you take any type of question, the two things that need to be focused on are, one is understanding the context, and the other one is identifying the charge. Now, understanding the context in a sense, the meaning of each and every sentence or each and every idea must be understood best. That is understanding the context. And identifying the charge in a sense, whether a question or an idea carries a positive charge or a negative charge. These are two things we need to focus on. Now, the way you eliminate options in the case of mathematics using the charge, the same way you can eliminate in the options in the case of English using the charge. Now, when you take a question, you identify the charge of the question. If the question is positively charged, the answer must also be positively charged. So all the negative options can be eliminated. Similarly, if the question is negatively charged, the answer must also be negatively charged. So all the positive options can be eliminated. So these are two things we need to focus on while approaching every type of verbal question. Now there are many strategies that help us understand the context. There are many strategies that help us identify the charge. Now, all the concepts we discuss in the online sessions will be based only on these two, the context and the charge. Now, there's no meaning in approaching a question blindly. In the sense, there's no meaning in going for guesswork. Guesswork will never help us. The only thing is going by the concepts, right? So, we'll take you through all the concepts in detail in the online sessions before we start with the application part. And we'll try solving the exercises based only on the concepts. That means if it is elimination or selection, we should go for it only based on the concepts. If you say A is your answer, if you go for option A as your answer, you need to have a valid logical reason for selecting A, and you need to have valid logical reasons for eliminating the other options, right? We'll go for all those in detail in our online classes before we start with the application part, the exercise part. Now this session, I'll take you through some previous year questions and see how we can eliminate the options based on some simple rules, right? Come to the first question. Now we should think about all the rules that have come in every sentence. Now every sentence will have at least 5 rules, right? In these days of inflation, a 10 rupees note will not buy you even an ordinary meal, right? In these days of inflation, we'll start from the very beginning, right? Divide into different parts and examine. In these days of inflation, now these pronouns, this, that, these, those, they are pronouns and they are termed as demonstrative pronouns. Now they are called demonstrative pronouns because we use these pronouns only when we demonstrate something, refer to something in specific, like this boy, these boys, that boy, those boys, etc. Now, as you know, this and that are singular, and these and those are plural, right? This and that are singular pronouns. These and those are plural pronouns. This and these are for something that is nearby, like this table, these tables, whereas that and those are for something that is at a distance, like that table, those tables, etc. So this, that, these, those are termed as demonstrative pronouns. This and that are singular, these and those are plural. Now as this and that are singular, the noun along with this and that must also be singular. Similarly, as these and those are plural, the noun along with these and those must also be plural. If I write this kinds, these kind, that kinds, those kind. Now all these are wrong usages. The noun along with this and that must be singular. The noun along with these and those must be plural. These kinds is a wrong usage because this kinds is a wrong usage because this is a singular pronoun. Kinds becomes a plural noun. So this kinds is wrong. It must be this kind. These kind is also a wrong usage. These is a plural pronoun. So noun along with must also be plural. So it must be these kinds. That is singular. The noun along with it must also be singular. So it must be that kind. Those kind is wrong. Those is a plural pronoun. The noun along with it must also be plural. So it must be those kinds. This kind, these kinds, that kind, those kinds. This boy, these boys, that boy, those boys. Right. So these days of inflation. Days is a plural noun. So these days is a correct usage. These is a plural pronoun and the noun along with these is also plural, days. So there's no error in part A. In these days of inflation, a 10 rupees note will not buy you even an ordinary meal. A 10 rupees note. A 10 rupees note is a wrong usage. The reason is, note is a noun. Now if you're able to identify the part of speech, it will surely help us in the case of grammar-based questions like spotting the error, sentence improvement, close test and fill-in-the-blank questions. In the case of close test and fill-in-the-blanks, when you come across a blank, just see whether the blank must be filled with a word belonging to which part of speech. If the blank must be filled with a noun, all the options that are not nouns can be eliminated. Similarly, if the blank must be filled with an adjective, all the options that are not adjectives can be eliminated. So identifying the part of speech will surely help us, as I said, in the case of spotting the error, sentence improvement, close test and fill in the blank questions. Right. Now, a 10 rupee note, I say that note is a noun. Simple reason is, a is an article. Now, there are three articles in English, a, an, and the. A, an, and the articles are used with nouns. After every article, there will be a noun. A, an, and the articles are always used with nouns. So, a 10 rupees note in the sense, note becomes a noun. Simple reason is, a is an article. Now, two nouns cannot come together. They must be separated by a comma, colon, semicolon, hyphen, etc. Right? Or connected by conjunction like and, or. So, two nouns cannot come together. If you want to identify the part of speech of every word, in fact, don't take words together. Take every word as a single unit if you want to identify the part of speech. Because part of speech is for each and every word. Note is a noun. I say, according to this one, 10 rupees is describing note. Note is a noun. Any word that describes a noun is called an adjective. So 10 rupees becomes an adjective. Now the rule is this, an adjective cannot be used in the plural form. Right? An adjective cannot be used in the plural form. If I say, I have a 3 years old baby, is a wrong usage. It must be, I have a 3 year old baby. Baby is a noun because of the article a. So 3 year old becomes an adjective. As I said, an adjective cannot be used in the plural form. So I have a 3 years old baby. Adjective is used in the plural form. Grammatically wrong. It must be I have a 3 year old old baby. It is a 2 hours movie. It's a wrong usage. Movie is a noun. So 2 hours becomes an adjective. Adjective cannot be used in the plural form. So it is a 2 hours movie is a wrong usage. It must be it is a 2 hour movie. We shall take a 5 minutes break. Wrong usage. Break is a noun because of the article a. So adjective cannot be used in the plural form, I said. So it must be we shall take a 5 minute break. Now the noodles packet, Maggi noodles packet, you'll find 2 minute noodles or 2 minutes noodles. You will not find 2 minutes noodles, it will always be 2 minute noodles. Simple reason is, noodles is a noun, 2 minute becomes an adjective. Cannot be used in the plural form. So it must be 2 minute noodles, right? Toothbrush or teeth brush. Tooth is a singular word, is singular, teeth is plural. We brush all our 32 teeth, right? Even though we brush our 32 teeth, it's not called teeth brush, it's called toothbrush. Adjective cannot be used in the plural form. So same reason here, note is a noun because of the article a. So 10 rupees becomes an adjective. An adjective can never be used in the plural form. So a 10 rupees note is a wrong usage. It must be a 10 rupee note. A 100 rupee note, a 5 rupee coin, etc. He has given me a 100 rupee note. Note is a noun, 100 becomes an adjective. So it's very clear that there is in part B. A 10 rupees note is wrong. It must be a 10 rupee. We'll complete the statement. A 10 rupee note will not buy you even an ordinary meal. Meal is a noun here because of the article an, right? And according to the statement, the word ordinary is describing meal. Meal is a noun. Any word that describes a noun is called an adjective. So ordinary becomes an adjective, right? Will not buy is the correct usage. Part B. It's always will, shall, would, may, might, must, should, have to, need to, ought to, has to, had to, do, does, did, all these plus V1 plural, right? It's always all these plus V1 plural. So will not buy, instead of will, it is will not, that's the only thing. Will not buy is will plus buy is V1. Now every verb has three forms, every main verb. Action has three forms, V1, V2, V3. V1 is called the present form, V2 is the past form, V3 is the past participle form. Buy is V1, V2 is bought, V3 is also bought. It's buy, bought, bought. So buy is V1 and it is plural. Now when does a verb become singular? Whenever there is S, ES or IES to a verb, the verb is singular. If no S, no ES, no IES, that means a verb is plural, right? If I write play, place, do, does, fly, flies. All these are verbs. My question is the left hand side singular or right hand side singular? That's my question. I say the right hand side is singular and the left hand side is plural. As I said, when there is S, ES or IES to a verb, the verb is singular. And if no S, no ES, no IES, the verb is plural. Place is singular because of the S. Does is singular because of the ES. And flies is singular because of the IES. Whereas play, do and fly are plural because no S, no ES, no IES. Now as I said, will, shall, would, may, might, can, could, must, should, have to, need to, ought to, has to, had to, do, does, did. The past tense of will and shall is would. The past tense of shall is not should. The past tense of both will and shall is would. The past tense of can is could. The past tense of may is might. The past tense of both do and does is did. Right. So it's always these words plus V1 plural. Part B says will not buy. Will not buy, buy is V1 plural because no S, no ES, no IES. As always, will plus V1 plural, that is also completely fine. Therein, this statement is in part B. So, correct sentence must be in these days of inflation. Inflation is a noun here because words ending with ION, MENT, ITY, AGE, These are usually nouns. One word can be used in different parts of speech. And when you refer to dictionary, the word will be here, the meanings will last today. One word has many meanings. And before the meaning of a word, in brackets, the part of speech will be given. So one word can be used in different parts of speech. The meaning of a word and the part of speech of a word depends on the sentence in which a word appears. Right? We'll take you through all these in detail in the sessions on parts of speech. Right? So inflation is a noun here because it's an IUN word. These words ending with these are usually nouns. So in these days of inflation, a 10 rupee note will not buy you even an ordinary meal. Now you understand how many rules we came across in this statement. So one statement has many rules, and only if you think about all the rules and all the topics. These rules appear in many topics. Pronouns, right? We have subject of agreement here. We have parts of speech here. Everything is there, right? So only if you think about all the rules and all the topics, you can find out the error in a sentence. Now there's no meaning in moving on to a previous question without a good knowledge of all the topics. When you go for a previous question, you need to find out based on which topic there is. For that, you need to be well-versed in the rules of the language. Come to the next question. He walks as if the earth belonged to him. Now, every topic has a set of rules, right? And every topic has a set of exceptions as well. So we have no choice. We have to go for the rules and the exceptions by heart. In fact, the rules and the exceptions are to make our task very easy. There's no need for us to think too much and waste our time. We can directly move on to the exact answer if you know the rules by it. He walks as if the earth belonged to him. Now, this question is based on the exceptions that come in the topic tenses, right? Now, in the topic tenses, we have some exceptions, right? We'll take you through the rules first. We'll tell you about the application part, and after that we'll take you to the exceptions, right? Because every topic has a set of exceptions. This usage, the usage as if has a rule of its own. Now as if is the same as though, right? The usage as if has a rule of its own. Now the rule is this, listen. If the idea before as if is in the simple present tense, the idea after as if must be in the simple past tense. You know the structures, right? In the case of tenses, first we have to learn the structures by heart. Now, three tenses divide into 12 categories. The four categories each, altogether 12 categories. Every category has got its own structure. Now, we need to know the structures by heart because when you go for a question on voice or speech, the first thing that needs to be done is identifying the tense and the category of the sentence that is given as a question. If you go wrong with identifying that, you will never get the answer. And if you know structures by heart, you can easily crack questions on both voice and speech. Right. Simple present, structure is subject plus V1. Simple past is subject plus V2. So the idea before as if is in the simple present tense. The idea after as if must be in the simple past tense. That's one rule. One more rule. If the idea before as if is in the simple past tense, the idea after as if must be in the past perfect tense. Simple past is subject plus V2, and past perfect is subject plus had plus V3. Right? So the idea before as if is simple present, the idea after as if must be simple past. If the idea before as if is simple past, the idea after as if must be past perfect. Right. If I go for a statement like, she spoke to me as if she had known everything. She spoke to me as if she had known everything. Right. Now, the idea before as if is she spoke to me. And if you write down the order of a sentence, you can easily identify the tense and the category. She spoke to me. She is a subject here. Spoke is V2. Speak, spoke, spoken. Subject plus V2 is simple past. So, idea before as if is a simple past tense. The idea after as if must be in the past perfect tense. As if she had known everything. The subject here is she plus had plus known is V3. Know is V1, knew is V2, known is V3. It's know, knew, known. So subject plus had plus V3 is past perfect tense. Before as if, simple past. After as if, past perfect. The second rule. The ID before as if is in the simple past tense. The ID after as if is in the past perfect tense. So she spoke to me as if she had known everything is grammatically correct. The same one will frame it in the first rule, in the first form. The ID before as if simple present. The ID after as if simple past. Now this idea in the first form becomes she speaks to me as if she knew everything. She speaks to me as if she knew everything. She speaks to me. The subject here is she plus speaks is V1. Subject plus V1 is simple present. So idea after as if must be in the simple past tense. As if she knew everything. The subject is she plus knew is V2. Subject plus V2 is simple past. The idea before as if is simple present. The idea after as if is simple past. She speaks to me as if she knew everything is grammatically correct. So this is a rule regarding the usage as if. Right. Now, she speaks to me, present tense. She knew everything, past tense. The sentence started in the present, ended in the past. There's no tense consistency here. Tense consistency means from the beginning to the end, a sentence must be in the same tense. If it begins in the present, up to the end, it must be in the present. Past, the same. Future, the same. If you think about tense consistency, you can eliminate options in the case of spotting the error, sentence improvement, close test, and fill in the blank questions. Right? But even though tense consistency is not there in this statement, it started in the past, present, ended in the past. Even though tense consistency is not there, this statement is grammatically correct because of the exception with the usage as if. Now, as I said, this rule comes in the exceptions on tenses. Now come to statement 2. He walks as if the earth belonged to him. The idea before as if is he walks. The subject here is he. Walks is V1. Subject plus V1 is simple present. So before as if, simple present. After as if, it must be simple past. As if the earth belonged to him. The subject here is the earth. Belonged is V2. Subject plus V2 is simple past. Before as if, simple present. After as if, simple past. This statement is grammatically correct. There's no error in this sentence. Getting it? Right. Come to the next one. Many a man have come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanently. Right? Many a man have come from India to Bangladesh to live here permanently. Now, many is a determiner. Many, some, a few, 90%, 3/4, various, several, numerous, much, more than, all these words are termed as determiners. A determiner is a word that tells us about the quantity of a noun. Many boys, many is determiner. Some men, some is determiner. A few girls, a few is a determiner. 90% of children, 90% is a determiner. Various techniques, various is a determiner. Numerous books, numerous is a determiner. So any word that tells us about the quantity of a noun is termed as a determiner. Determiners don't deserve importance. Right? Don't get stuck with a determiner statement. Just neglect them. Determiners don't deserve importance. Focus only on the noun in the sentence. Right? Many is a determiner telling us about the quantity of a noun. Right? If I write, many children. Many child. Fine. Many children. Many a child. Many child, many children. Now my question is, which of these are correct usages? Come to first one. Many children is a correct usage. Many a child, correct usage. many child, wrong usage. Many a children, wrong usage. Similarly, many girls, many a girl, many girl, many a girls. Many girls is the correct usage. Many a girl is also correct usage. I'll explain this. Many girl is a wrong usage. Many a girls is also a wrong usage. Many girls is the same as many a girl. Now, many girls is a colloquial usage. Colloquial means like C-O-L-L-O-Q-I-L, what we use every day while speaking, right? Spoken way, the spoken syntax, spoken language. Many girls is a colloquial usage, right? Colloquial means like local one. What we use every day while speaking. Many a girl is a standard usage. Now these two mean the same. The only thing is the first one is colloquial, the second one is standard. That's the only difference, right? Come to third one. Many girl. It cannot be many girl, it must be many girls. Many a girls is a wrong usage because a and an can always is are always used with singular countable nouns. A boy, an umbrella, a girl, a book, right? So a and an can be used only with singular countable nouns. So a girls means girls is a plural noun. So this is also a wrong usage. Many children is a correct usage, and that is the same as many a child. Many tables is the same as many a table. Many girls is the same as many a girl. Many books is the same as many a book. So many children is the same as many a child. Now come to the statement once again. Many a man is a correct usage. And many a man is the same as many men. Many men is a colloquial usage. Many a man is a standard usage. That's the only difference. Many a man have come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanently. Now as I said, don't give any importance to determiners. Focus only on the noun in the sentence, right? Many a man, many is a determiner, telling us about the quantity of the noun. So forget about many. The noun here is a man. A man is singular. The simple reason is a tells us that the subject is singular. A and an always tell us that the subject is singular. So a man means singular. And if a subject is singular, the verb must also be singular. Subject, verb, agreement. Have is a plural verb. So that is the error. It cannot be have. It must be has. So many a man has is a correct usage. Many a man has come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanently. Now many a man has. Many men have. The same way. Many is a determiner, forget about it. The noun here is men, plural. And the subject is plural, the verb must also be plural. And have is a verb which is plural. So many a man has, many men have. The same meaning, the only thing is expressed in two different forms. Many children have, many a child has. A child is singular, the verb must also be singular, has. Many girls have, many a girl has. Now we got the answer, there is in part 2. Now, sorry. To make this sentence grammatically correct, we can change either part 1 or part 2. If I change part 1 this way, many men have come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanently, grammatically correct. Or if I change part 2, many a man has come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanently, grammatically correct. So to make the given statement grammatically fine, we can change even either part A or part B, right? In the case of spotting the error, our task is to find out the part that contains the error. That is called spotting the error. We'll never read a sentence from the left to the, from the right to the left. We'll read only from the left to the right. Now, it's all about moving from the left to the right and trying to find out the part that contains the error, and that is called spotting the error. Many a man, till here there is no error. Many a man is the correct usage. So till here there is no error. Then if I say have, the second part does not go with the first part. So error in the given statement is in part 2. That means in this context, the correct statement must be many a man has come to India from Bangladesh to live here permanent. right? So error is in part 2. Got it? Right.